This morning we will talk about bull and terrier, so in the more showman's terms. So then they say you have a type that looks particularly more to the bull side, so that's a bull type, so more of a bulldog. Then you have a type that's more to the terrier type, or better yet, this one, more to the terrier type. And then you have something in between, and that is a bull and terrier type, so the balance type. But the thing is, if you look at those balanced types, those bull and terrier types, they are still almost a complete copy of the working bulldog. When the bulldog, the English bulldog, was still working bulls and other things. So, balanced type, I think this is all a load of rubbish. And the result is that some people will tell you that, for example, show Staffordshire Bull Terrier is more of a bull and terrier than, for example, a working Border Terrier or even a working Patterdale Terrier. And like I have here, this is a working bred Patterdale Terrier. So we don't work light in Europe, boot times clothes. And let me start with understanding why he came to that conclusion, but I will also tell you why I think this conclusion is not right. So I understand why he came to that conclusion, because he looks from the perspective that the judges at shows will tell you how they should look and what makes a bull type or a terrier type more lanky, bulls more solid. And a bull and terrier, as they call it, the balanced type, so the type that you want to see for example, Staffordshire Bull Terrier. But those interpretations change over time. One of the things that is quite funny to tell is that also the Staffordshire Bull Terrier has two separate show classifications in time. So first, the show dogs had to adhere to a dog that was closer to the original bull and terrier, the pit dog, and those dogs were higher and at the same weight as the current show Staffordshire Bull Terriers, that are lower, quite some centimeters at the width is lower, but remain the same weight. And if you now currently look at the show standard, then you see dogs that are easily bulkier than those of the second, which was already a more exaggerated show guideline. So they can still say, okay, it's approximately that size, but the weight is getting heavier and heavier, so the dogs are getting more exaggerated as time moves on. And that's the bad thing with a lot of dog breeds. Also, you see that the back lengths, you see more of a working type back length, quite a long body that's capable, flexible, and also brings a lot of strength from the back, is diminishing over time. And that gives you an even more solid look. Huh? Remember, a look can be completely different than functionality. And of course, this will give to the novice especially, the more compact the dog is, for example also in the American Bully, it gives you more indication of Hulk-like persona. Huh? So it gives indication of massive strength, which very often is not that much the case. You need a certain back length to make room for the lungs, to give you flexibility, to also give you strength when you're shaking and doing your bull and terrier things. Then back to the reason why I don't agree that a working Border Terrier, working Patterdale Terrier or the likes is less bull and terrier than the showbred Staffordshire Bull Terrier. In my opinion, if you look indeed into these show fairy tales, in my opinion. It gives you the balance between the bulldog in this case, and the terrier. And the best, they're called half and half. So those pit dogs that resulted from that. In my opinion, if you look at the Staffordshire Bull Terrier, they carry at least 75% bulldog blood, the working bulldog blood, and 25% terrier blood. And why do I come to that conclusion? If you look at the working bulldogs of this time, they resemble, as I mentioned also in my introduction, quite a lot the Staffordshire Bull Terrier. Also in America, they say that the American Pit Bull Terrier, the fanciest, often say this is the original bulldog with minimal influence of terrier. So that's one point. So if you indeed would cross that all-time working bulldog with an all-time terrier, the dogs, the half and half dogs, would be a little bit more athletic than your average Staffordshire Bull Terrier or your average American Staffordshire Terrier, both show versions. So that's one point. And if that is correct, then a dog also with a little bit more terrier influence could be more balanced bull and terrier than a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, because they already are 75% or higher more of a working English bulldog type. So that's one important point in my opinion. And the other thing is, beauty is what beauty does, or handsome is what handsome does. The bull and terrier, the bull gives you the indication that there was a dog capable of handling the bull, and the terrier was a dog that was capable of going underground. Terra means earth, of course. So dogs that do that work should be considered a bulldog or a terrier dog. And the bull and terriers were also working breeds. So dogs capable of performing and tested to do the job. And then if you even look in the litters of, for example, game dogs, like American Pit Bull Terriers, or dogs that are used for hog hunting, like Dogo Argentinos, or the likes, or you look at the terriers, dogs that are used for earthwork, not all those dogs in those litters also make the grade. And if you can imagine that you would not test for that for like 90 years or more, or 90 generations perhaps even, in many show dogs, you can understand that you can lose it. There's a saying, use it or lose it. That also goes with the Bull and Terriers, or even more so with the Bull and Terriers, because some traits, like an athletic ability or speed or a good build, can be conserved quite easily on the eye, just by using eyesight. But testing a dog's courage is a lot harder to do, and that also gives you more insight that dogs are now being bred to look the part, especially to a novice. The more exaggerated looks, and oftentimes should be very easy in the ring, so that they can easily show those dogs without showing their boldness. But also to show the boldness in the ring is completely different than the boldness you would find when a dog does its work. For example, the boldness needed to engage a hawk in the case of a Dogo Argentino is completely different than the boldness needed to face a dog in the show ring. And the other way around also with terrier works, when they face off with a badger or the likes, or the American Pit Bull Terrier, when they are some geography still used for dog fighting, same as the Japanese Tose Inu. Those dogs have a completely different set of also mental attributes. So therefore I would say that a working Border Terrier or a working Pattedale Terrier might be more Bull and Terrier in the functional department, And also, if you look at that mix, that they say the half and half, then you have a show Staffordshire Bull Terrier. That's not being said that an average show Staffordshire Bull Terrier could not be the fluke, that they are able to perform some of the original tasks or are very courageous. Sometimes you do have them, but as mentioned also, when you don't select for those traits for so many years, you will lose a lot. Whereas Border Terriers that are still being bred to work for the same amount of years or generational Pattedale Terriers, of course, do have a higher percentage of those characteristics. Hope you like this video. Have a great day. In this video, we will describe the origin of three types of molosses. One being the livestock protection breed, two being the mastiff types, and three being the bulldogs. So to start with an important fact, a lot of people will tell you that the livestock guardian breeds are the original molosses, and that all other types of mastiffs, for example, are derivatives of such livestock guardian breeds. And then they say the Tibetan mastiff is the granddaddy to them all. This has long been taken as truth and be taken for granted, but genetic studies just display that they have a completely different set of genes than the mastiff group. So it could be that the Tibetan mastiff was once one of the earliest livestock protection breeds, but it's not the case, it is the earliest mastiff. And also the name mastiff should not be applied in the original sense. So the mastiffs are dogs of a different descendant. The livestock protection breeds were there to protect the livestock against predators especially, and also sometimes humans. Whereas the mastiffs were developed as dogs of war and dogs of hunting. So for example, to deal with combat situation, so to say. So to fight men in wars, but also horses, and even in hunting properties. These are the more of the catch dog type of dogs. So the dogs that exchange it with hawks, so in this case swines, but also were used as a dog that can handle domesticated animals such as cattle, that is very reluctant to work. So not like a herding type of breed, but more of a catch dog type of breed. And this is also the origin of a subdivision of this mastiffs, and that were the bulldogs. And these dogs were a lot smaller, but also a lot more courageous and still very capable. So whereas a mastiff would go by courage, but also especially a big size, a bulldog would be there till the end. Even if they could not make it, they will hang on there. And then a smaller dog will be beneficial to a degree. And why? If a bulldog grabs and holds, for example, a bull, and the bull will pull its head back, then normally the dog would be flown off the bull. But a bulldog, which has a very strong mouth and relatively little body weight, was able to hold on. So it's a different type of breed, and also different type of work. A molosser, in case of a mastiff that was there to handle the bull, should rely on grabbing the bull, and then being an overly heavy and strong and muscular dog that can make it hard for the bull to throw him off. Whereas the bulldog could be relatively small, and even an enormous strong bull could not shake it off. And that made a different type of dog. And also, then the last gradation of this, where the bulldogs had transcended into the pit dogs. So many people will still tell you that the American Pit Bull Terrier is the original bulldog, and I think they are right to a high degree, but there was some influence of terrier type of dogs as well, and they were called bull and terrier, of course, also displaying this terrier type, and also were called half and half. But I do agree that it could be that the bulldog has more influence than a terrier had, so like a quarter terrier, three quarters bulldog would very well be the case. And also, if you look at the original bulldogs that were still handling the bulls, they look a lot like the modern day working bull and terrier. For example, a modern day working Staffordshire Bull Terrier, or even a show version, or a modern day American Pit Bull Terrier, or American Staffordshire Terrier. Then there were also some dogs that were called bulldogs, but were a little bit bigger than the bulldogs that I described that were developed in England. Had these blood-baiting gladiators that were really very capable. And why were they smaller in England? Because it wasn't allowed to keep mastiffs for the normal people, and also it wasn't allowed to do many a blood sport when time progressed. So they bred the dogs smaller. It's also the reason that the first pit dogs that hit the United States, where they further evolved into the American Pit Bull Terrier, were quite small type of dogs that was, they were easier to hide from plain sight, and also easier to transport by ship, of course. But there were some dogs, for example the Kadabaw, which also transfers to a bulldog, or for example the Alano Espanol, that were more running type of mastiff. So as I mentioned, the mastiff was there to be a war dog, and of course there was not always war, so they had two distinct types that were the most dominant. So of the mastiff types, you had the dogs that were really there to guard. These dogs were very big and strong, and also had a very good guarding proposition, good man-stopping ability. So a dog that is able to pull and push a man to ground and even get stabbed, but through the multiple layers and thick layers of skin and especially muscles, it would still be hard to get off. This could be the ultimate protection breed. And then they had a running type of mastiff, and that was especially useful for hunting properties. And hunting properties, I mean for the hunt on boar or other types of quarry that were able to hold their own. Some were even used against wolves. And these running type of mastiffs are more of the Alano Espanol, or the Alown type, as we also know them in England. So a lot faster on their feet, but still very capable at holding their own. And I think also in a battlefield scenario, when there was war, both types would be used, of this Molosser type mastiff subdivision. So I hope this video helps you a lot, to give you a little bit of more of insight of the different strains of molosses and their origin. Also, I hope it helps to see that livestock protection breeds are completely different than more of the warlike protection or hunting type of mastiff, and that the bulldog is a subdivision of that, in a smaller body, relatively stronger bite even compared to body weight, also a lot more courage, and that this also has evolved to the ultimate bloodsport gladiator that we now know, for example, as the American Pit Bull Terrier of today.
Have a great day.
The dog on the leash is a Petterdale Terrier, a small type of Earth Terrier. He's done now. See, the weight has become even tighter now. Have a great day, all.